So, let me just remind you. Right, so last time we talked about the function from Rn to R is differentiable at some point called t rather than j of k. If two things happen, p is in the interior of the domain, so it's not an isolated point, not on the edge, and also if you take the limit as x goes to p of f of x minus f of p divided by that distance minus, there is a vector a so that that's the same as a dotted with the unit vector x minus p slinged. Right? And so here, so that's the definition, and in fact, a is, that's a triangle, is the gradient of f at p, it's a vector, which is the vector of partial derivatives. But right? So this we did last time. So what this is really saying equals zero. So those two things tend to the same. Somebody would say we don't have to divide by the lengths, but we do, because if you don't divide by the lengths, then you just have the limit of one thing going to zero minus another thing. Was that you?
Yeah,
it's just you have zero minus zero. So of course, it's always zero as long as that limit exists. Right? Because if we don't divide by these lengths, and this goes to zero, this goes to zero, there's nothing interesting going on. We can put any vector here. But if you divide by the lengths, this is saying, just like in the single variable case, if you look on, so this says, on a really small scale, f of x, well, looks like, so looks like is a very fuzzy term, a constant, that's this part, plus the projection onto some vector A. And so the projection onto some vector A. Right? That's what that's saying. If, so this business, so this is, gives you a unit vector, or this business and this business is really saying on a really small scale, because we blow it up to a normal size. So this is sort of the same as in the single variable case. If we, here's my analog of P, and I blow up this picture, So this distance is my x minus p, well, twice, width. And I blow up this picture. And then I blow up this picture again. And I keep blowing this picture up, and more it looks like a straight line with slope. Well, in this case, the slope is, well, whatever, with this negative slope. It looks more and more like a straight line, where this slope here is the derivative. Now here, we don't really have a slope, because my function is well, in two variables, I have some surface. My surface here, my point P, and I zoom in, I blow this up so that it looks more and more flat. And this vector A is giving me this tangent plane. Well, it's not really the tangent plane. It's giving me something about this slope. In fact, I'm drawing the wrong vector, it's this vector. It's actually where it tilts the most. And this is a projection. The change here is pretty much the direction. If I go in some direction like this, and I look at how much I move in this direction, it gives me kind of the same thing. So this vector is playing the role of this slope. Yeah.
You said P is at zero. Don't mean my function.
Yeah. That's just to rule out. So
that's P necessary to be in the domain of
function. Yeah. So P is a point where the function is defined. If it's not in the domain of the function, this doesn't make any sense. And not only does it have to be in the domain of the function, it can't be at the edge. So I can't, just like in this case, if this function ends here, I can't take the derivative at the edge. And similarly, if this thing has a hard edge, I can't take the derivative here. Or if I have an isolated point here where it's defined, I can't take the derivative at that isolated point. So we have the same condition in one variable. We have to have a neighborhood or an interval around the point where we're taking the derivative. We can't take the derivative just at the edge of where it's defined. And the same thing here. We have to be able to take this limit in all directions. We can't have a cut, because then weird stuff could happen. Okay? So we really need, in the domain of, if this is P, we really need all around so that we can come in from all the directions and look at that limit. Yeah?
Is the idea of coming in from all sides is like analogous to like left-sided and right-sided?
Yes. Okay. It's like we have left-sided and right-sided limits, so in one variable, there's only two ways you can come. You can come from above or below. Here, I want to be able to come from above, below, right, left, up, down, partway through, all the variations. I need space around it. On the line, right, on the line, I just need space around it, but there's only two ways to go. So this is this statement is the analog of saying I have both left and right limits. This is just saying I have left, right, and all combinations of up and down and all around. Yeah.
So what is the gradient function unit?
It's the vector that, it's the vector where the function increases the most. It's the direction in which the function is steepest. But we'll see that in a little while, but this, so it gives us a direction, right? The gradient that doesn't live, so I at first drew this, and that's wrong, because the gradient doesn't live in that space, right? The gradient I'll draw a picture of that. So again, I have to think of, I mean, I can draw my surface. So I'm going to draw a picture as a function from R2 to R. But I want to think of, so I take this plane and I lift it up there to get my surface. So this height, so this is the land where x and y live, and this height is the f of x, y direction. And if I have some point p, p lives here. P is a combination of x's and y's. Right? And the gradient vector, so the gradient vector here lives here. The gradient vector is some relationship between x's and y's that tells me about the tangent plane.
So it's a function, it's not a number.
Well, it's a number, it's a vector. It's not a number, it's a vector, it's constant. Just like the derivative at, so just like if f, let's call it g. If g of x is x squared plus 5x, g prime of 1, let's do 2. G prime of 2 is 2 times 2 plus 5 is 9. It's a number. And that is the slope that tells me how much g is changing at this point. Similarly, if f of xy is x squared y plus 5x, there we go, then the gradient of f at some point 1, 2 is, so now I have to compute the partial with respect to x, so that gives me 2xy plus 5, and the partial with respect to y gives me x squared. Evaluated at 1, 2, which is 4 plus 5 is 9, and 1. So this guy, this vector 9, 1, is telling me that if I increase 9 in the x and 1 in the y, that's like the slope. That's the place where the function increases the most. Okay. Yeah.
Isn't the gradient technically defined for three variables? So to be technically
any number you want.
It can be any number.
Okay. Yeah. This is a gradient too.
Okay.
It's a gradient of a function from R to R, so it's the vector 9, which is right.
Yeah.
And I can define the gradient for 23 variables if I want. It doesn't matter. It's easiest to visualize in the case of either two or three variables but it's all the same. So one thing that you should keep in mind is everything we do in this class should apply, if you interpret it correctly, to single variable calculus. So here when we have a gradient, we have a one vector, which is also a scalar. So the derivative is a gradient. Not a very interesting vector. So you should always, when we talk about something, you should say, how does that compare to the thing I already know? How is it extending that other notion? And because that's really what the whole point of this is take the stuff that you worked out in one variable and extend it to more than one variable. See that it's the same thing if you think about it the right way. Okay? All right, so we did that, and I remembered we did that. So this is, this is a very important idea. Yeah?
Is there a concept of the gradient, like for vector value functions, where you have like from R2 to R3?
Yeah, that's what I want to get to today.
Okay.
It's called the derivative.
Wow.
So the gradient is like a special derivative. but we want to generalize that to functions from R2 to R3 or R1 to R3, all of those things, right? But we're not quite there yet. But we're kind of, I mean, if you think about it a little bit, you could probably figure out what it's going to be, because it's kind of like the gradient. So we've already covered the case, so let me not tell you yet, but I hope we'll get there. We already talked about a function from R to Rn, and we know what f prime of t means as a vector, and we've also talked about, I'll use g now, some function g from Rn to R, and we have this gradient object, which is also a vector. And you want to sort of, maybe one of these should be M. You want to sort of put these two ideas together. They're sort of, one goes one way, and one goes the other way. So it shouldn't be surprising if we have some H from Rn to Rm is going to be. These are both vectors, but they're sort of vectors measuring two opposite things. So this would be a matrix. So H prime. The derivative of H is a matrix. So this is a linear approximation of this function, and it has to be a vector. This is a linear approximation. This tells us something about the linear approximation to this. And it's a vector, but it's sort of a vector in the input side. This is an output vector, this is an input vector. And this we need to consider both how do the inputs vary and how do the outputs vary in the matrix. So I'll come back to that, I hope, in about half an hour, 20 minutes, something like that. But I'm not quite ready to go along. Other questions or? No, you had a question.
Yeah, I think
I forgot you long ago. I'm sorry.
It's okay. So A, gradient vector, that assures us that you drew that little circle with the squiggly arrows from all directions, and no matter what direction X approaches from, A will be able to scope it out, whether it's limiting
properties. So I mean, in this picture, there's going to be some vector A here. And we can approximate, so f is going to take this picture, and it's going to send it, well, to some height, or some width, whatever, okay, right? So think of it as just squishing. And we want to say, well, gee, how does f affect, I have other colors, let me use another color. How does f affect stuff along this line? Well, the gradient, to figure out how much going to change along that line, we can just sort of look at how it changes along A, and that gives us some idea of how F moves everywhere. So we can pick any direction here and somehow see how F transforms these green things by just looking at the projection of that on how F deals with A.
And the projection, all the different color lines should somehow match up.
Yeah. I mean, it's only on a very small scale. Right? On a very small scale, this function f, maybe it stretches a lot here, right? So, this picture isn't very good, but on a very small scale, maybe f grows a lot here, and only a little bit here. But on a very small scale, there's some constant rate of change. What a derivative does is it replaces something nonlinear with something linear. And our linear map is just a dot product of some vector. And so this A is the vector that we're taking the dot product with. This A is also called the gradient of f. The gradient of f is the vector on which the function acts like a dot product with. Remember, a dot product, I have one vector, and I have another vector. And if I take the dot product of these two, it's giving me something about the projection onto that. Well, in some sense, all linear maps from Rn to R are just like a dot product. I'm just taking combinations of the x's and the y's.
Okay, this is.
It's okay. This is a really important point.
If you come in on a line orthogonal to the A, gradient
should be
A,
zero.
So then the function should be in that small neighborhood constant.
That's right. So think. I mean, if you think about some tangent plane, because the thing is essentially a tangent plane. And I know that it's steepest this way. This direction, this is now think of it as lifting this up. This is the place where it grows the most. That's the way to walk uphill the fastest. Well, if I go orthogonal to that, I'm not going uphill at all. Right? These are the contour lines. This is, I don't go up, I don't go down, I just go opposite from up. I don't, you know, up's that way, down's this way, and I just walk along the tightrope. And if I go a little bit above, well then, my gain is just how much of that I actually used. So this thing, is like having a little arrow that says this way up, you know, to the top. And that's what that gives us. It tells us the direction in which the thing grows the most. Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't hear what your exact statement was about dotting a vector with a gradient vector.
Gives you the amount that vector sees of the gradient. Right? If I have two vectors and I take their dot product, I'm essentially taking the projection of the one vector. It's the angle between them.
Right.
So I'm taking the component of that vector in that direction, scaled by its length.
Yeah. And the reason for this is that dot product was like projection times the absolute value.
It is.
So would we have to account for the absolute value?
Yes.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
So I'm being a little fuzzy when I'm saying projection.
Okay.
It's just like a derivative is the projection onto the line that it started with, but then scaled by how much it stretches.
So when you are looking at something very small, what you're doing is taking a vector, and like let's say we have a vector in free space.
Mm-hmm.
I take a vector on the xy plane and dot that with a gradient, and that would give me how much?
Well, the gradient has to have something to do with the function.
Right.
Right. I can't just take an arbitrary gradient.
Or the, no,
so let me talk a little. Let me say another thing, and then we'll come back to it.
All right. Cool.
Okay. We're all right with this. I hope maybe. All right, somewhat, kind of, sort of. Okay, so I'll leave that. That picture has nothing to do with anything, but I'll just have this. I'll leave this up. Although I don't know why. Okay, so this gradient function is a kind of a derivative. But it's not really the derivative, but it says something about the derivative. And now let's try. So we already had this idea of the partial of f with respect to some variable x, right? So if I have f of x, y, I don't care, z, whatever, that this is the limit, let's say at some point p, as x goes to p, let's say t goes to 0. Well, let's do t goes to 0. Of f of x plus t, y, whatever, all of the variables. Let's just do xy minus f of, oh, this is, yeah. Okay, let's just do it that way. Xy over t, right? This is our derivative in the x direction. This is a number. It's a scalar. It is not a vector. But we have several of these. We can fix any any particular coordinate vector we like. We look at a limit like this. It gives us the slope, the amount of change in that direction. Well, we don't have to be limited to the coordinate directions to do this. We could, by analogy, say, suppose we take any vector v, which is not zero. We don't want the zero vector, but we take some vector v. We could make a similar limit. So this is the derivative with respect to some vector, which we could take as the limit as t goes to 0 of f of x plus that vector minus f of x over t. So we can certainly define this thing. Remember, x is a vector, t times v is a vector. So you can certainly do this. Whether it means anything or not is a different question, but we can certainly do this. Right? So we can just pick some vector and look at the derivative. Let's just define the derivative with respect to that vector, which is some combination of x and y. Is this. So, as an example, and I'm not saying what it means, it's just a thing. So we could take v to be the vector 1, 2, and f of, let's just do two variables, to be, I don't know, x, y squared.
Maybe x.
Let's do x. Okay. And so now I can define, if I want, the partial with respect to the vector 1, 2. Derivative with respect to the vector 1, 2. So this is sort of a direction, but it also has a length. It's just defined to be the limit as t goes to 0 of, write it out, x plus t cubed, y plus 2t squared minus x cubed y squared over t.
Do I have to divide by 8? No.
Right? So this is something. But in fact, but I don't want to do that limit. What would this thing be? I mean, so you can do it out, you can take the limit, blah blah blah. Yeah. Okay, have a guess.
The derivative in the x direction plus the derivative in the y direction times 2.
Okay, so the claim,
the guess,
let's call it a guess. Yes. This is, you're saying this is x, 3x squared y squared times 2. Plus x cubed 2y, oops, times 1 times 2. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay. People think that's maybe true?
The value or what it means?
Huh?
The value?
I don't care for you about what it means. It's just a limit.
think it's true? Why not? Sure. Let's just say it's 7.
I think so.
No.
X's and Y's here.
So, so what is this? This is the gradient of F dotted with V. Which is where you came up with 1, 2, blah, blah, blah. Right. So this is the gradient of F dotted with V. Now, really, I've been just thinking about everything at a point. But fine, think of x and y as constant here. So that's fine. So that's actually true. So this is just a definition that we can just define for the heck of it. But, so this is actually, I don't know, we can call it a theorem. That df dv, this funny vector derivative, is in fact always the gradient of f dotted with v. So if f is differentiable at the point where it matters, in a neighborhood of that point, then that's true. It's differentiable at x. So in other words, just what we said there. So it's, if V is V1, V2, V3 up to Vn, then this is V1 partial F partial X1 plus V2 partial F partial X2 blah 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 plus part Vn partial F partial Xn. So let me prove that. Although, I don't know, does this seem reasonable to people, or does it just seem like I'm just writing garbage? Or maybe both. A combination of the both. Okay, so here. So I'm differentiable at some vector x. Thinking of x as fixed, then the partial here at x is the gradient at x. So let's see why this is true. And then I actually only want to see what it means in a special case. So f is differentiable. It's differentiable at some vector x. And so now I'm going to think of x as playing the role of p here in this definition. And I need some other letter to put for the x here. So let's call that s. So by the definition of what that means, if I write here, should I write here instead of Stuart to see here? Is it okay?
Yeah.
So since f is differentiable at s, I'll just copy that down. That's the limit as my variable s tends to my fixed thing x of f of s the vector minus f of x the vector over the distance between s and x minus the gradient of f evaluated at x dotted with s minus x over its length. So that's just rewriting the definition of, you know, I know A is a gradient. So that's just rewriting that with the substitution using s for the thing that moves and x for the thing it moves to. Right? Okay, so now in the special case, not is, if. Anyway. So if we take s to be x moved a little bit in the v direction,
right? That's all that says. So just think of t as some small number, and it just says start at x and move away from x by t times my vector v. Then we can just rewrite this. Oh, this equals 0. I always forget the equals 0 part. So that equals 0. Let's write it here. 0 equals that. So that equals this. So I can rewrite this. This is the limit. Well, since s equals x plus tv, that's the same thing as saying tv goes to 0, or t goes to 0. So I can just put a t goes to 0 here. And then here I get f of x plus tv minus f of x. That's just this part. And let's put them all over one fraction. Minus gradient of f at x. And then s minus x is tv. And this is just leftover nonsense. And then we divide everything by the length of s minus x. So that's the length of the vector t. So these are equal. So this is 0. Yeah? Okay. So now what? Well, I can cancel this t out. And so t is going, since this is 0, I don't care about the sign of t. So if I change the sign, it's still going to 0. So that means that I can divide t by absolute t, and it's still going to 0. Right? So I can cancel out this t. I don't know why I put them together. I want to split them up. So this t and this t can cancel out. There. And yeah. And here I don't really want to do much to it, except maybe let's put the v out in front. So let's actually write this. I'll do it. This same thing. There. So I have a fact. This is a number. I can fit this. And remember, this whole thing equals 0. This is a number, so I can just multiply through by this number. This number isn't 0. So I just forget about the v on the bottom. And since this whole thing equals 0, I can just move it over there. So that's what I wanted.
Yes.
So I'm done. Yeah.
Okay, so you proved that using the one definition of the gradient?
I used the definition, not really of the gradient, but of the derivative. But yeah. So, right, the function has a derivative, or it's differentiable, if there is some vector, which we happen to call the gradient, or here we can call A, whatever. There's some vector, who we call grad F, so that this is true.
In that definition, is A defined to be what you would call A?
Sure. I mean, this notation we adopted as this vector. And then we showed that that will be the vector of partials. So if you remember last time, we just said, there's some vector. It's a vector, whatever. And I'm going to call that vector A, but I'm tired of writing A, so I'm going to start writing this. And that vector, by the way, happens to be the vector consisting of the partials. So So this is not a definition. Yes. And it's in the book. You can read it in the book. But this is not a definition. This is a fact. This falls out of this definition. So given that, so I didn't really use this part in there. I just did the thing using that definition, changing the letters around, calling X, S, and
you
then I get that. Is there another question? Okay, so that means that whatever the heck this thing represents, it's easy to calculate. And it represents something, which is something not actually very useful, but it's a thing. But in the special case, it is useful. And that special case is, so the useful case. And then we can forget about the other part. If V is a unit vector, so let's call it U, then taking the derivative with respect to the unit vector, well, the theorem tells us that this is the gradient of F dotted with that unit vector. And this is called the directional derivative. Or if you prefer, it's the derivative in the direction U. So let's just do this same example again, where we take U to be, well, I don't want 1, 2, because the length of that vector is not 1. I want it to be a unit vector, so I have to divide by root 3, root 5. So that's a unit vector that goes in the direction parallel to 1, 2. And if I take, let me also write it, sometimes this notation is a big D with a little U here. So it's D sub U of F. So the directional derivative of F in this U direction is whatever that number was. Oh, I didn't do it at a point. So let's do it at a point. At 1, 1 is, I've lost, what is F? Let's write what F is. F is x cubed, x cubed y squared. So F is F of xy is x cubed y squared. So let's calculate the directional derivative of f at the point 1, 1. Well, it's just take the partials, 3x squared, 3x squared y squared, 2x cubed y, dotted with 1 over root 5, 2 over root 5. And evaluate this at 1, 1. So that's 3, 2 dotted with 1 over root 5, 2 over root 5, which is 3 over root 5 plus 2 over root 5, which is 7 over root 5.
It doesn't matter if you evaluate it before or after.
No, because this is a vector.
So then the first partials are just special cases of the directional derivative.
Exactly. So the first partial is just the directional derivative in the x direction and in the y direction. And what this is this is the rate of change in the u direction. This one is kind of stupid. It's the rate of change in the v direction times the length of v, which is kind of, I don't know, not so useful. It would be like taking the derivative with respect to 3x. Usually you don't take the derivative with respect to 3x. So here, if once we divide it and make it a normal length, then it's something kind of useful. And this is exactly, I guess I'll come way back over here. So what this is, again, let's just say I have my surface here. And I choose some direction u, like that, which is saying here on this surface, those things are just lifting up, my function looks something like that. This is in the u direction. And I'm just looking at, if I cut this thing open, I take out a saw, and I cut it like this, I cut it along the u line, then I have a graph. Here, which corresponds to this slice, and then at this point, wherever my point is, here, this is the slope of that cut. That cut is not parallel to x, it's not parallel to y necessarily, it's just at some angle, some combination of x's and y's, and that just tells me the slope if I cut that thing open and look there. Right, so I'm going to cut it going more y than x, twice as much y as x in this case. Right? Well, that picture is totally screwed. Increase y twice as much as x, and I get some slice like that. Okay? So this directional derivative gives me that kind of a measurement. So it's the slope of the tangent in the u direction. Questions about that? So, you know, I'm sorry I don't do a whole lot of examples, but we only have a little bit of time, so. It's for Aloysius to do all the
examples.
Yeah.
Okay. What are the axes on that plane that you just drew? Is one the vector?
I'm sorry?
What are the axes on the plane that you just drew?
Okay, so the axes on this plane, so this picture is not the 1-2 vector that I talked about, because the axes in this picture typically would be like that, and so this is something like the vector -1, -1, +2, something like that. Right? X is negative in this vector that I
drew. I mean, you know where you have vector on the up
here?
No,
here.
Right next to it. No. So yeah, that one.
Okay.
What are the two axes?
So what I did here to make this picture, I cut this thing open in this direction. And so cut it open in this direction. This surface cuts that plane in some direction, and my axes on that direction. So here, this picture is, I draw now this picture, the green, and I lay it down flat, and I see that. So it's not the standard axes. It's I've rotated my axes so that my horizontal axis aligns with u. And that's the picture I'll see. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I got it. Thanks.
So this would enable us to, for example, take a derivative of a function with respect to negative x, because we look in the negative 1 direction, which will just flip it around and give us the negative slope of what we had before. But okay. Other questions on directional derivative? They're very easy to calculate. You just take the gradient and you dot it with the vector that you want. And that's what it means. It means the derivative in the slope in that particular direction.
Can I ask
okay. Yeah, sure.
Staggeringly simple question. What's the advantage of using directional derivative versus derivatives in the standard coordinate directions?
Maybe you want to know. Suppose you have a function that describes, I don't know, the rate of increase of something. So suppose it's an economics problem. So I have some, you know, I know that the revenue or the cost of producing something is take the amount of, you have three inputs, A, B, and C. So let me not, you have sand, you have water, and you have gold. And you're going to do something with sand, water, and gold. And the cost of it is the square of the amount of gold and the quarter of the amount of sand and the cosine of the amount of water. That makes no sense at all, but that's what it is. Okay? And so now I have, now I know that I'm always going to mix them in the ratio 3:1:2. So if I increase my amount by a little bit, how much will my cost increase? Well, I'm doing it in the ratio 3:1:2. And so I really want a directional derivative in the direction of 3:1:2. But of course, I don't want the 3:1:2 to count, so I want to divide by the length of, so what's that, 9, 10, 14. So I'll take the directional derivative of that cost function in the 3:1:2 direction. So and that will tell me how much, if I increase a little bit, how much does my cost increase?
Because both easier and conceptually clearer.
Yes.
But it's not the only way.
Yeah. It's just, right? It's just a way of saying I'm specializing to a specific line. Also, if you imagine that you have some hillside where I have some surface like that, and I have some curve that goes along that surface. How much is it increasing right now? Well, that will be the directional derivative in the direction of the tangent of that curve. Right? That will correspond exactly to the tangent vector of that curve. So maybe in the base, I'm tracing out some spiral path, and so on this hillside, how much do I go up? Or down in this case, if I trace out that spiral path, I don't know what that path is. That's complicated. But it's easy to calculate because I can just say, well, at that point, I just want to look at the directional derivative in that direction tangent to that curve. That tells me how much I'm dropping along that path.
Okay.
Okay. I don't know that we're going to get there. I will try. I guess I really kind of want to say this. So, one other thing that I want to mention, and don't worry too much about it, but I think it's worth mentioning. Maybe you remember from single variable calculus, there is this theorem called the mean value theorem. It says that if I have a nice function and I take two points A and B, that there's a point somewhere in between, in this case, well, how about that one? There's also another one there. There's some point in between where the tangent line is parallel to or has the same slope as the difference in the values, right? So the mean value theorem says if f is differentiable on some interval AB, I guess it's open, then there exists some C in that interval so that f prime of C is the same as fb minus fa over b minus a. Right, so that's the one variable mean value is zero. And this has, is, you know, when you do this in calculus one, people go, yeah, why do I care? What the heck is this? Blah, 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 blah. But you need this to be able to prove a lot of things. And in particular, one consequence of this theorem, which seems kind of stupid, but it's true, is that if the derivative of a function is zero, then that function is constant. So this implies if f prime of x is zero on some interval, then fx is constant. So that's one use that follows from the mean value theorem is to be able to prove that fact. You prove early on that the derivative of a constant is zero, but this says that's the only way you can get a zero derivative on an interval, right? This is a singularity effect. So there is a mean value theorem for more than one variable. But the mean value theorem is really like a line kind of thing. So the mean value theorem for, say, some function from Rn to R. So suppose I have a line. I'm going to use gamma. Maybe I should. I'll use S. From, say, P to Q. And it's all inside the domain of F. So F is defined in some open blob, and there's a straight line connecting two points P and Q. Oh, shoot, I changed my notation. Oh, well. Then, and F is differentiable. Around that line, then there's some point, let's call it C, there's some vector C on that line, so that, and I guess I need to move up there, so that difference in the values, I guess I'll do Q, and the Q is the n. It's the same as the gradient of f evaluated in C, dotted with the vector Q minus P. So this is sort of a directional derivative version of the mean value theorem. But this is just the mean value theorem interpreted in the context of a directional derivative. But what that means, so let me not prove the mean value theorem. There's a proof of it in the book. It works exactly as the proof of the mean value theorem in one variable, except you have to make sure everything's a vector where it needs to be a vector. So this means that if the gradient of f is a constant on some open, is zero, is the zero vector on some open set, let's call it a blob, some connected, in the domain of f, then f is a constant. So again, exactly by analogy with the one variable proof, it generalizes to the two variable. Now, it needs to be connected, right? If I have a function where the gradient is zero here, and even if it sort of sneaks inside, and then the gradient is zero here, that doesn't mean that the function is constant, because these could be different constants. In the same way, with a single variable, if I know the derivative is zero here and the derivative is zero here, it doesn't mean the function is constant. Right? So, okay. The wrong name on this. Okay. So I just want to mention that. It makes me feel bad if I don't at least mention it. Any questions at all on that? So, yeah. I mean, this is really just the mean value theorem in one variable, but viewed along the line that maybe it's just a ratio of x to y. It's really just the mean value theorem in one variable. So, I guess I did say I would get to something, so let's get there. So now let's move up some dimensions. Let's consider general functions. So now I'm going to consider f taking Rn to Rm. So this function takes in an n vector and gives out an m vector. And so associated to this, we don't have a derivative vector. So what we want, not one, some magic, we want df or f prime derivative. Well, the derivative is always linear approximation. Well, linear maps are matrices. A linear map from Rn to Rm is an m by n matrix. It's just a combination of all of the variables in each of the variables. Right? So if I take an m by n matrix and I multiply it by, so if I take 1, 2, 3, 4, so there's from 2 to 2, times xy, this gives me x plus 2y is the new x variable and 3y plus, sorry. 3x plus 4y, new y variable. This is just a linear map in each of the components. And when I have some mapping f, well, let's just do r, I don't know, r3, r2, let's just have an example. So this would be something like f of x, y, z is, well, I get 3 coordinate functions. I get, say, x squared plus 2z, xyz, z plus x plus cosine y. It sure is. I meant to stop at 2. Okay. So I put in 3, outcome 2. Right? Yeah, otherwise it would be R3. So I want to approximate this by some linear, some matrix thing. Well, but if you think about it, this is just, I have some function f1 of x, y, z here, and f2 of x, y, z here. And I already know how to calculate derivatives with respect to a function from R3 to R1. The gradient tells me that. I know how to calculate from R3 to R1. So each of these coordinates I can view as separate functions from Rn into R. Or I could cut it the other way, and I could look at the column vectors. Well, except I have far too many. I could also look the other way. Okay, so that means what I want to do is some combination of gradients. Right? So, I guess I'll move this way. So that means that what I can do is just define derivative matrix. Well, I just take the partial of f1 with respect to x, and the partial, well, let's call it x1, partial of f1 with respect to x2, and let's see, how far across do I go, m or n? I always forget. That at n. Partial of f1 with respect to xn. And then down this way, I take partials of each component function until I get to the last one.
Oh, I got the last one, didn't I?
That's an N. That's an M. Right? So I just take all of the... So these are the gradients of each of the component functions, but I'm not adding them. I'm just listing them. These are gradient vectors. So I'm not dotting them. And these guys are actually the tangent vectors with respect to a given coordinate. So, the columns are tangent vectors, and the rows are gradient vectors. So maybe I should do an example or two. I guess I'm moving this way. So I should probably be speaking in Hebrew or Arabic. They don't know this one. So maybe an example. Let's say f of x. Well, I wrote one over there. Let's use that example. F of x, y, z is, I can write it just this way, x squared plus 2z x, y, z. So then, the derivative matrix going to be, well, it's going to be 3 by 2. So I'm going to have the partial of this guy with respect to x, the partial of this guy, partial of this guy with respect to y, the partial of this guy with respect to z, the partial of this guy with respect to x, the partial of this guy with respect to y, the partial of this guy with respect to z. And at a given point, so say, one, two, three, this will be just plug in. 2, 0, 2, 6, 3, 2. And this tells us that this tells us something about how this function of three variables changes when I vary those three variables. Vary tells us very much when I vary the variables. Verily. Okay, so this tells us that near the point, near 1, 2, 3, the function x squared plus 2z xyz is a lot like what is f of 1, 2, 3? What is it? So 1, 2, 3 is 1 plus 6 is 7 and 6. So it's a lot like 7, 6 plus 2, 0, 2, 6, 3, 2 times, let's call it u, v. X, y, z, sorry. Let's call it delta x, delta y, delta z. Or x, well, fine. So this is saying, so that is 7 plus 2 delta x plus 2 delta z, 6 plus 6 delta x plus 3 delta y plus 2 delta z. And again, thinking delta x, delta z, these are small quantities, so maybe we could also write 7 plus 2 times x minus 1, 2 times z minus 3, 6 plus 6 times x minus 1, plus 3 times y minus 2, plus 2 times z minus 3. Putting together all of the stuff that we've already done, where we're just looking at how it varies in each of the output components, and that gives us a derivative matrix. So maybe another way to say the same statement, in the 2 minutes that are left, is so I have some function f from Rn to Rm, then I have a tangent approximation, so I have some point near some point P in Rn, then the tangent approximation to my vector x is going to be my function evaluated at the point plus my derivative matrix evaluated at the point dotted with the distance between the x vector and the point, where I think of this as a column. Because this is a matrix and the dimensions will be wrong if I don't write that as a column. My tangent approximation is the value plus how far away I moved in the various input directions times the derivative matrix. Okay? So that sort of puts everything together for a general function from Rn to Rm. I'll do a couple more examples next time, and then we'll move on to vector fields, which are still the same kind of thing for n equal to. Okay? I will update the homework in a few weeks.